Okay, since the baseball season is open both at the university and nationally, and I would assume maybe in Japan as well, we're going to do a quantum mechanical relativistic baseball diamond, which I've mentioned a little bit already. But today we are going to build a construction. It'll basically be a redo of the construction that you should have already completed with homework, with some little additions that make a big difference. So the review is just mostly one page here. On the right, I'm just going through the main results of the development of the rapidity number, which is really a key quantity that makes things really easy to do relativistic problems, almost do them in your head once you have this little quantity here, which is the logarithm of the Doppler shift receiver over source. And that factor is dimensionless. In this case, the inverse of that equation gives the that factor as an exponential of the rapidity. So we're going to be writing all of our equations today, pretty much, in terms of that function. Functions of rapidity are all you need for relativity. Now later on, and this is probably something for next time, we're going to show an entirely different approach to relativity given by guys whose name rhymes with Einstein. This is Lewis Carroll Epstein, a professor emeritus now at City College of San Francisco. We'll talk more about that later, but what we're going to find is, by merging that with what we're doing here, is that another parameter, which is I call the transverse parameter for relativity, is how much a light wave bends that's perpendicular to your motion. So far with this, we're talking about the Doppler shifts you see in color as you go toward or away from a laser source. That's longitudinal. This other one is an angle, and all of the circular trigonometry can be used for it. We're going to be doing hyperbolic trigonometry today. Those two are the two sides of the same coin. So that's the key thing here, and the rapidity is a beautiful relationship with that angle. Now, this is the algebraic thing that we didn't do with that, and that was, after we'd gotten through making Galileo happy by having a parameter which would add precisely at all speeds, and there's no limit to this parameter, it doesn't stop at C. That's just getting warmed up at 1.0. But at small velocities, the parameter is equal to the old-fashioned relativity parameter, which is the ratio of velocity, relative velocity, to that of light, U over C. And we need a relationship between that old parameter, beta is the usual notation for it. Beta of Alice relative to Bob, for example, is the velocity of Alice relative to Bob divided by C. So there needs to be a relationship between those two. This one being an inconvenient by the fact that it stops at C. This one goes on forever, but does the nice addition and is a very good parameter for the Lorentz symmetry group. Now, after we get done doing this relationship, I think you'll see some of the ideas of what's coming next year, the group and the phase velocity that you worked with on the homework coming out. But then we're going to do it again because it never hurts to repeat things that are such complexity. Even though I claim it's terribly simple, I know that it's not for somebody just coming upon it the first time. So I want to review this half sum and half difference business and take us back to some elementary stuff that's on this Pirelli site, and look at just briefly to review this. So this is all review here that we'll get through fairly quickly. Then it's time to let the whole saga of Bob, Alice, and Carla produce coordinate systems and study how those work, and then develop basically the geometrical theory of relativity, which involves a Minkowski coordinate grid. And that's coming out not too long after Einstein published his 1905 papers. But unfortunately, Hermann Minkowski, had called Einstein a fat, and I'm not sure whether it was a fat dog or a fat lazy dog or a fat lazy person or something, but an insult, a terrible insult, especially when Einstein is German and Hermann Minkowski has a Polish name, and here we have some race relations that are going on with these guys. You know, they're supposed to be using the top part of their heads, but they're not. And that really made Einstein very leery, or at least never wanted to use these coordinates. So all of the stuff that was written after that didn't have Minkowski's thing in it, and he died in 1909, 4 years or so later, so he never got to push the thing himself. Anyway, we're going to be building those coordinates, just letting lasers build them for us. And then we're going to go through and exhaustively catalog the numbers that make all of the relativity and later the quantum mechanics work. And this is a part of this is something I want you to do with the homework. Basically, what I want you to do for next Thursday is do what we're going to do today at the velocity of 3/5 speed. I want you to up it a little bit and do it the geometry of 4/5, 80% the speed of light instead of a mere 60%. Well, 60% is pretty fast, as you know. Okay, let's get with this. Review of this is but this is basically what we're going to be doing this whole period, and probably a good part of the next, is play out the scenario in all of its different aspects. So let's just see what it is we have here. Cartoons about things moving fast. In this case, as different from when we started yesterday, these two lasers are moving really fast. They're moving so fast that their 600 terahertz frequency has been blue shifted for Bob up to 1200 terahertz. And the laser that's running away from him, or that he's running away from, namely Carla's laser, is going just as fast as Alice's over here, as indicated by the cartoon lines, and she's with it, and she's with this one, and she's going at this speed, as is she, UAB relative to Bob, that's Alice relative to Bob. It's funny notation that we have to be careful with. Anyway, this is a laser that is directed to the right, and this is a laser that's directed to the left, and it's going so fast that it's Doppler shifted by the same factor, but it's down from 600 to 300. So that's the situation, and the algebra that we need to develop in this space right here, a relationship of rapidity with the old parameter beta U over C, involves the K vector or the kappa, either one. If this is kappa, then this is nu. This is k here, so it's omega. I've got an extra 2 pi attached. This one right here, kr, k from the laser that's directed to the right. Now, the confusing thing about this is that I can't say the right laser, because the laser is way, way far away on the left, but it's directing its beam to the right, and that's what Bob sees. And then this one is a laser on the right directed to the left. Okay, and that means that there's a minus sign on its K vector. So the left laser, that's Carlos, has a minus sign multiplying this relationship here. So this is just a relationship, omega equals CK, as is this one, but the K in this case is positive, in this case the K is negative. So that's the stage setting here, and we're talking about plane waves with those k's. Okay, is this any questions about this setup? It's going to be here for a while as we build something out of it, but this is an important piece of derivation I don't usually take much care for, because I thought it was too simple. But it's not, it's worthwhile doing it this way. So what I'm going to do here, and this is kind of like what's in the text that I've given you last week, we're going to ask two questions. Here's Bob sitting here in this weird situation, two light beams are hitting, and he looks this way and he says, wow, 1200 terahertz, he really better have some eye and face protection for that. But then on the other side, the Carlos laser doesn't look anywhere near as ferocious, it's just some nice infrared. Neither of these are what we call visible light, but this is the one that I said keeps you warm. That's what you're feeling right now from the atmosphere in the room here. And the question that I want to ask is, to what velocity must Bob accelerate so that he sees these two beams with the same frequency? In other words, what does he have to, what velocity does he have to get to catch up with these two girls? Okay? That's what we're asking here. So velocity ue for equal, the question is, to what velocity must Bob accelerate so he sees the beams with an equal frequency, whatever that is? Yes, TC.
So we really have two different scenarios that we have on the board right now. This is the old one where we're composing, mm-hmm. we're adding velocities of the same beam. Here we have two separate beams. It's two different scenarios.
We have what I would say is a framework managed by these two people, okay? And they are, according to Bob, in motion. Now, they don't see it that way. They see they've got some nice green lasers like we had set up before, making a nice standing wave in there, right? And here's Bob ripping this way through that, right? So either way, that of course is the key thing, is either one of those stories completely right, and it has to work. So waves make it work is really what happens. Okay, and then the second question, what is that frequency? Okay, we kind of know the answer to that, 600, but let's calculate it, you see, by using this relationship and the one that we need to develop, the relationship with rapidity. Okay, so I'm going to answer this question Jeopardy style. The answer to this query right here has a Jeopardy style answer by question. And that question is, what is the beam group velocity? What group velocity does he see as these beams intermesh and make an interference pattern that's moving at some speed? And that's the thing that's easily measured. Group velocity is very easy to measure. Phase velocity is a lot harder, maybe sometimes impossible to measure sometimes. But group velocity, we can do it. Okay? So, given that the group is a half difference, remember, frequency, and k is the half difference of the k's, are right minus left for each of those quantities. Okay? And then the velocity itself is the ratio frequency, so many per seconds, divided by so many waves per meter. So that's the group velocity that we know. Now the halves cancel, so all I get is the difference of the frequencies over the difference of the k's, straight away, no one half. Okay? But then we use this relation up here, k is omega r over c with a plus sign, KL is omega L over C with a minus sign, okay, going in there. So that means now we have a numerator, it's just like it was, but I put a frequency in a denominator and a plus sign on the left laser, left-directed laser, namely this one. Okay? So far, so good. All right? Now, in that case, we have frequencies here that he's seeing, 1,200. And 300 respectively. Okay, so 1200 minus 300, 900 over 1500. 9 over 15, 3 over 5. That's the speed. That's what it takes to get this situation of one octave Doppler shift, either up or down. And you have to do both at once by time reversal. All right? So that's cool. That's a nice way to, something nice to know. When you see two beams of light coming from either side, you can go somewhere where they actually are in what we call the rest frame. All the other frames are going to be these crazy Lorentz things we're going to talk about today. And that's what we're going to do most of the time today. Now, similar style for the answer to this one. And the question is, what frequency is a blue shift of this lowly infrared, that is upshift, what factor B do I multiply that to get the same thing as a red shift, that is the lower that one, that is divide by B. Okay, that's a simple equation to solve. Okay, so this equal frequency has to be the blue shift of the one from the red thing from the left, and that's supposed to be equal to, by construction here, that the this one would be if it were red shifted. And they're both going to be blue shifted and red shifted enough as he accelerates to catch up with these people. Okay? So that gives you, when you put the b over here, b squared, and then this thing in the denominator, the b is equal to the square root of the ratio of r to l. Okay? That's kind of neat. Except that I can replace either l or r by this equation here and get a really nice little equation here. There's the geometry in this. This is where we find out, once again, the things that the lighter is doing is geometric. The result is going to be the geometrical mean of these two frequencies. And what do you suppose that is? 600 terahertz, which is what's written on the lasers. Okay? Make sense? But we still don't have this relationship to this thing. That takes a little bit of looking at the blue shift as an exponential, which is really what I always want to look at. So we've got two exponentials here, a positive exponential and a minus exponential. Blue and red. Okay? And we've got this relationship, the definition of the rapidity. Okay, in this case, Malvik, Bob, and Alice. Right? So, we're given that the right laser there is a blue shift of 600. The left laser is a red shift, that's a minus of blue, with a minus of rapidity of the 600. Okay? That's easily, I'll put in an equation that gives us this. I stick those frequencies in there. I get in the numerator here an e to the plus exponential minus an e to the minus exponential. That's this. And then I get down here e to the plus again, but this time plus the minus. Okay? And what is that? What the hyperbolic sine. So we're going to be seeing these functions as the trigonometry of the geometry of all of our relativity and quantum mechanics. This is really where it gets very cool. That's a hyperbolic tangent. That's the answer right there. This relativity parameter, the ratio of velocity to c, the beta, that quantity is the hyperbolic tangent of the rapidity. So good? Okay. Well, we'll see it in another form as we build the geometry over on the board and on a piece of paper on your desk. Okay, let's take a quick review of what it's like when these people aren't moving at great speeds. This is what it looks like at home. This is the rest frame for this laser beam, this 2CW laser beam that's coming together, presumably to interfere, not look like that, not look like that, but look like a piece of graph paper in space and time. These are all numbers we talked about before. We're talking about 600 terahertz, which is a half micron wavelength. It has a period of 5/3 femtoseconds. Okay, that's the 600 terahertz being this basis for all of this scenarios that we're making up today. So when these guys come together, they produce this thing that you've we've looked at the animation of this, and it's certainly spectacular in the sense that the zeros for the standing wave go nowhere. That's why it's called a standing wave. But we have just the opposite situation with the phase. The real part of the wave, bang, 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 every half period, it goes infinitely fast. That is, it's everywhere at once, and then it's gone until the next half period comes by. So what we're doing here is the half sum and half difference in order to analyze those two pieces, shall we say, factors. We're factoring this thing to find the zeros. And so we're using this half sum plus half difference and half sum minus half difference to factor this sum into that and that. Okay, so we're going to be taking this thing here with its phase kx minus omega t. That's the laser that's going to the right. And then the laser that's going to the left has a minus sign on the k, but the frequency is the same sign. And those two go together here to make a half sum and a half difference. Those two coalesce to make that. These two come together to make that. The most easy factoring that you could ever imagine. Something much simpler than what you have to do in high school algebra. This exponential algebra is quite trivial. So there is a factor here that is just the sum. That's 2 times the cosine. And you see the frequencies drop out. This does not vary with time in this case. It's because it's a standing wave. This green thing here, this envelope, not moving, not doing anything at all. It's the heartbeat inside. That's this factor right here that's beating. That's the phase part. I'm using green for the group and some blue thing to indicate the real part of the complex wave, the part that makes it live, so to speak, its heartbeat. So what we find is that the phase part is the x dependency that cancels completely out. Okay, we're just left with minus I omega t. The phase factor and the group factor are really simple. So there's the simplest complex way that you can have something that varies with x, and then that variation with x of the group pinches off an otherwise perfect cosine wave or sine wave that real and imaginary parts are both inside there, inside the envelope or group wave. Okay? Makes sense, more or less? Okay. Now this is the heart of everything we're going to be doing from now on. This is what makes it work right here. We're just going to change some numbers and get relativity and quantum mechanics, basically. It begins as you analyze what it was that this did. Now, today I've given you a piece of graph paper that has the same setup, and I'll point to it right here, the same setup with linear dispersion. That's the laser that Alice has, and she's over on the other side here directing a beam toward me to the right. And it's 600 terahertz, so that's what we start with. That's called first base in the baseball analogy, okay? And then the third base over here, that's the vector that represents the frequency and the wave number being along the horizontal axis for this laser right here, the one that's sending, in this case, both of them are sending green to Bob, and he's just fascinated by the fact that he's been able to get a piece of graph paper in space and time plotted out by his data-taking devices that his good spectroscopers have nowadays. Okay, so the idea of having a half sum, which is the phase, and again, baseball helps us here. This is pitcher's mound, and a half difference, that is this thing minus this thing over 2, is this thing, this g for group, but then Woody across the way here, I put a little thanks in here for him. I was used to call this the dugout, you know, it has a g in it, but it's not in front. He says, hey, grandstand, that's what it is. So here's the grandstand for the baseball diamond of the home team. Okay, they usually put you on the right side, okay? So that's the mnemonic for G and P. If you're tuned to baseball, which everybody in this room, I guess, knows enough about baseball that this makes some sense, okay? Now imagine when I have people from parts of Europe where they just play cricket or the soccer, right? You know, what the hell I'm talking about, so that doesn't work too well. Anyway, I want to be careful to notice, and you should see this, these two switch over here. This one over here is saying, hey, phase, when you see it over there, it's going to have infinite of speed because the slope is going to be infinite for this, right? So you look at this one the way you look at slope, relative horizon, okay? And that indicates that's going infinitely fast over there, okay? Meanwhile, the group is just laying down flat on the ground, right? No slope at all. And that means that the group wave over there isn't moving at all. Just the opposite. They're going infinitely fast, going not at all. And then when we draw them, you find here's the group pointing along the thing that doesn't move, and here's the phase pointing along the thing that really moves. Okay? Now what we have to do is see what happens, what that looks like when you move through it. This will no longer be going infinitely fast, this will be going very fast. And the group will no longer be going zero, it'll be going whatever speed you're going relative to it. And that speed is going to be created by interference, beating. So that's the long and the short of this, right there. We'll see it again shortly here. Okay? So, what we want to do is talk about the collision and all of that. This is just written up in nice fancy little shadow scripts showing first base here that belongs to Alice. She's coming to the right, but she's over here. And then Carla, she's over there, but her laser is coming this way. So that's third base. Okay? And then the half sum. We don't really have anything for second base to do yet, but that comes later on in the quantum field theory. Like lots of bases. Okay. Let's see if I can show you something that's sort of the opposite of this. And that is, if I take a whole bunch of Fourier components and make a pulsed wave, and remember I poo-pooed the pulsed wave because that's the Einstein axiom, which is so hard to understand, and we used Occam's razor to cut one CW out of the maybe dozens or hundreds of Fourier components so that I could make a pulse here, but I could make something that really gave me a coordinate system. Well, now you get a baseball diamond in space-time when you do that. And we'll take a look at that with some animations in just a minute here. Okay. So this geometry applies to both, but you need to be a little bit careful about the things that happen. As I take this simple situation in which I only have one Fourier component come from this side and one from this side, and have a whole bunch of Fourier components coming with pulses, little particle-like things crashing into each other on the other hand. Okay. Now we've seen, I think I've seen enough of this particular animation, so I'm going to, just for the sake of time, go forward here. But notice that in this particular case, the phase and the group play the major role. I sort of dimmed out left and right. You don't see anything going left and right when they get on top of each other. You see square up and down and sideways. You see, you get things that go with these two vectors when you just have a nice single CW with a single CW making this arrangement right here. There's no sign of any baseball diamond here. At all. You just see these vectors here, and then if you look carefully, you notice that there's the peaks are headed along there, and there's some peaks headed along there, and then they're also headed in this direction. So if I add more Fourier components, maybe I can get rid of all this stuff and just have something doing that. Well, that's indeed what happens. That's what happens here. So if in per-space time I have a whole bunch of Fourier components, so that I pile up the waves into pulses like that and cancel out in between, get mostly zeros in between, that's the situation here. And that's the situation that Newton thought the whole world ran by. He thought that ultimately light was made of corpuscles. And that frequency, he didn't really conceive it, but he thought of it as the number of corpuscles that got patooey, patooey. There'd be something, if you knew about 600 terahertz, you'd say there was some really great spitting machine in there making that light goes like a machine gun at 600 terahertz producing the corpuscles, you see, which would then obey his laws for, you know, particles that he was so famous for. Okay? He completely got that wrong. Totally. That's just not the way it works. But you can see that if you pile them up, you get something that he would be happy with. Pulses running into each other. So let's take a quick look just to make sure that you see that, because there is one point I think I would like to make about this. And I'm going to pause this thing just for the sake of it. Right about there. See, I've already made a baseball diamond, sort of, beginning of one. But the idea is that what I've done here is if I had one CW, you see, it would be up, down, up. You see, there'd be a crest here, and a trough here. But when you add a whole bunch of them together, you get as many up troughs as you get down troughs. Whereas you always get a positive crest here and here, because that's where the wavelength, no matter how many cosines I have here that go like, they always come back to the top here. So they always add up right in this neighborhood and then cancel in here. That's why we don't have a pulse that goes down. That doesn't happen. That would make Newton very confused. There's plus corpuscles, and then there are these anti or negative corpuscles, right? That's what he would have to say with a situation like that. And the thing is, we don't get them. They cancel out. They interfere away destructively. Okay? So I wanted you to make sure you see that. Now, it also plays Newton's law. If I put a wall here, it looks like they're bouncing off of each other. But of course they aren't. They're just playing their modes the way things like to do when they're light, that is a linear dispersion. Okay, so that's the, a kind of a neat story. The corpuscles versus the wave thing is an argument that goes right today. Now, you see, we go back and forth thinking about these things, particularly light, as both. And that's something we're going to have to get our heads around eventually here. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and just pause this and get me back to the show here, so to speak. Let me bring up that one. So I'm glad this little guy can work and do this, because I've got some other things planned for this one here. So let's get this one sort of caught up here and maybe start using it a little bit, because there's some really fine stuff that we have to show next. This business right here, I took you through this a little bit last time. The arithmetic, you might say, the phasor arithmetic, was associated with a half sum and a half difference. Well, let's see if we can say a few more things about that. First of all, review what we said last time, but I would like to go ahead and bring up, if I can, this thing. Now, this, as I said, Galileo's Revenge Part 2, the fact that we can do relativity of actual phasors in phasor space. It's kind of weird, but certainly mathematically it's a fair game here. So now I am in this old website, and there's some things here that you should look at, but I really do like this analogy. It's just a little bit weird, but take two combs, okay, one with some fairly fine teeth and one with not so fine teeth, and put them on top of each other, and I'll see if I can get them straight here. There we go. And the question is, which way do those patterns move when I move the combs? Now, if I move this comb right here, you see, I go to the right and the patterns move to the right. You see that? Maybe I'm blocking. I should probably pull it like this. Maybe get back a ways here. As I move the comb on the top here, which is the coarse one, you'll see that they
camera angle.
Can you see? I should have gone and bought some of these great big combs that they have.
Just stand on the other side for this.
Pardon? Get on this side?
Yeah,
that's a good guess. So, what I'm, if you can see, if I move, I think everybody can see that. Okay, is that good? There, okay, I'm going to. There you see the just between my fingers I can make a pattern move this way. And what's funny is if I move the other comb to the right, the patterns go to the left. The top cone, though, when I move it to the right, the pattern goes with it. When it goes, you see, there it goes with it. I'm moving it to the right, and the pattern goes to the right. I move the comb in the back, and this is all relativity right here. I move it back, move it the other. It, all of the patterns always go opposite to it. Something you can play with if you have two combs, and then figure out how that works. Here's the explanation, just in terms of where the peaks are and where the valleys are, and where the peaks and valleys run into each other. You get nothing. That's right there, and where the peaks meet the peaks. You got something. So that there's a really simple way to explain beats. You're going to have kids, and they're going to be going to get science classes that are ever more challenging. So you things like this can help you. Let me go ahead here with this thing. And the way you do it is you just say go next. That's what we're doing: half sum and half difference. But why? Well, here's a really good way to say, we've got a difference between these two phasors. There's the half difference, okay? And then there's the half sum, sort of the average of the two. That's what we're really working with here, you see. And you can look at it either as two phasors rotating around, one faster than the other. The green is faster than the red, we know that. Green's 600 terahertz, the red's down in the 400 or even 300, okay, infrared. So that's giving you a sum of these two like that. That's the usual way. If people, when they rarely use phasors in physics, that would be the same thing. But to do it this way, it's kind of crazy. You just say, hey, I'm going around with the red, and I'm going to watch the green relative to me, which is just a circle around my nose, my red nose there, you see. And that's making a la the geometry that we're going to be talking about in a minute here, Thales' pattern, that is a right angle subtended by the diameter in the phasor that's moving. And then you can do it with, you can stand on the green and watch the red go backwards. So that's a really key thing to have here, and I'm going to go down here and get the sometimes the slides below the thing. So I'm going to go back here and I'm going to go on to the next one just to make sure that you see that if we didn't have complex numbers, we'd have to go through this. And this is what I think really prevents people from teaching waves at a low level, is you then go through the cosine laws, you see. Here I factor cosine alpha plus cosine beta into a half sum, half difference, and a half sum. I mean, just what we did in very quickly by complex numbers. And I'll skip that animation. You can look at it at your own time. But look at this. This is what we're really doing here. We've got a group wave. We multiply it by a phase wave. They're both cosines. But this one envelops that one. You see, they're the guts of the wave inside there. It's that thing right there being crushed by this one. Okay, that's what's going on in that construction, and in that's the one I favor, of course. There you see the both the elementary parts doing their thing inside the envelope. Okay. All right. I think that does us for the elementary thing that you can get on that particular website, and I would recommend it. If you're feeling confused about this some later date, I'm assuming you're not confused now because you're not asking questions. But we now are going to go on and do a construction on the graph paper that I gave you today, which is very much like the stuff that you did in your homework. It's good to review it from a different viewpoint. So once again, we're going to have a 1200 terahertz coming this way, colliding head-on and interfering with a 300 terahertz from these two laser jockeys that are womaning a 600 terahertz laser in both cases, and they are keeping the distance between each other the same, but they have, relative to Mr. Bob here, a very high speed, which we've already calculated is 3/5 the speed of light. So all this has to happen fairly quickly, or they have to be very large distances apart from each other. Okay, so what we're going to do, and I'm going to look at the simulations later for this, just to again save time, but those are always available for you when you come back to these notes. What I want to do is, first of all, draw the right and left wave vectors, that is, wave, what is hardly a name for something that has per space time as vectors there. So on the board here, what we're going to do is we're going to take a purple piece of chalk, and I'm going to draw a vector that represents the Doppler shift from 600 terahertz by a factor of 2 to 1200 terahertz in the case of the wave coming from Alice. That's this one. And then whenever that happens, immediately I have to take that same factor and divide it into the 600 terahertz that this side had. So the vectors that we're talking about here that are going to be giving us the, I thought I had a longer ruler. Oh, here it is. This one right here has gotten twice as long. So on your paper that has those dots, go ahead and draw one that goes all the way up the fourth dot, which is what you should have gotten with the homework to start off things there. So there is a great big ultraviolet wave vector that is going to interfere, that is half sum and half difference, with a very ungreen vector over here, and I'm using color. You're welcome to borrow the color from any of the crayons that are on the desk there if you want to do this in Technicolor. But there are the two vectors that we're talking about. And it's the sum and difference of those two, that is head to tail, that we're interested in. So while you're drawing that vector down there using the graph paper, you can draw another one just like it that's 5 my units here, whatever your units are. There's the other side of that baseball diamond, basically. What we've got now is a very bizarre baseball diamond where it's a marathon to first base, but it's only a short sprint over to second base at the top of this picture. So I'm going to have a vector that comes down from that side. That is the ultraviolet one. And that together makes a vector sum rectangle out of which we will build all subsequent geometry. But of course, these are the lines that the corpuscles would follow if light could do that, and light can do that with pulses, sort of. Okay, so that's the situation we have right now. Now, to find out where the half sum is, we have to do the sum first. So I simply take this ruler right here, and this is something that I definitely want to draw in blue because this is going to be the phase vector. And it's going to lie, if I can keep this thing steady, on a line, which I'll draw faintly here, that passes through that point. That's the point I'm interested in, which is the absolute center, the halfway point, for the vector sum. And so I will finish that line fairly darkly. I'll make that one a little bit heavier and put an arrowhead on it to indicate the new pitcher's mound. The new pitcher's mound, P prime, is sitting right here at the tip of this arrow. Okay? So it used to be over there at 600 terahertz. It sort of drifted up to this point right here. So there's P prime right there. And prime just means we've done a Lorentz transformation. We're already doing relativity. Might as well admit that. Okay? Now there's another vector there that we also should be looking at, and that is the vector that goes on the other diagonal of this rectangle, this sum force, they call it force rectangle, as opposed to a force triangle. So what I'm going to try to do here is get that lined up and draw a very faint green line along it that goes to that point there. And later this green line will do some interesting things for us. But right now, if you're liking to save time, and I guess I am too, I'm going to extend this because where these lines intersect either axis are important numbers with fancy names after them. Fitzgerald contraction, Lorentz contraction, Einstein time dilation, all that kind of stuff. They're all here waiting for you to read them off. But right now, I'm going to finish the group vector, and in particular, use the graph paper to put the group vector where it belongs. And I'm talking about this vector right here. I'll just draw it a little bit thicker with a little bit of an arrow on it, but I don't want it there, at least not for now. It's okay to be there. I want it down here. I want it parallel down here. And using the graph paper, I can just come from this center square here, one, two squares over, then go one square diagonal, another one, and then right about there is where he really belongs if you're going to put the origin of his vector at the place where it belongs on most vector diagrams. So what I've got here is that vector, the group vector, right there. I have to be a little careful here because this thing slips really easily. But that is the other side of the wave interference pattern will be right here. And that will be the new grandstand. You've got to remember where the old one was. I don't have it drawn here, but there is the new grandstand. Let's make it as green as possible, G for green. Okay, it used to be, this is G prime, the old G used to be down here. And what happens is it follows a path, which we're going to be very interested in, up from the place where it used to be with zero slope. And then this thing used to be infinite slope over here. So the original phase vector P is located, I'll just write it very small here, there. Okay? But this one is the one we're interested in. And of course, its location depends on the speeds we're talking about right now, 3/5 speed of light. Now, where do you see the speed of light, 3/5? Well, if you number axis using one unit for 300 terahertz, two units for 600, three for 900, four for 1200, 1500, which is way outside of your visible range, that would be 5. So that's 5 units up. Okay, oops, that was 1, 2, 3, 4. We're going to go there, okay? And then come across here. You see, that's where the P is pointing at. Its slope, that is the ratio of this height right here, 5, underneath, well, over 3. This is the phase. It has a speed greater than light. It has a speed of 5/3. It used to be infinite, but now it's dropped to only 5/3. Meanwhile, this one over here is 3/5. You see, this used to be 0. Now it's come up to 3/5. And that's the speed of the group wave that's standing in Alice and Carla's laser system. You see, that's what Bob is going to be seeing moving at 3/5 the speed of light. That's the way this works. The group is what you get to work with. The heartbeat is for some other purposes. The phase part. But it's the thing that makes things go, because it's always faster than light, whereas this one's always slower. No matter how fast you go, they just close in and get closer and closer, but they never cross. Okay, so that's the situation we have in this little picture right here that has the diagonals drawn in and some numbers put on. And that's the important part of this, is we're going to very quantitative make the formulas for all of our relativity starting now. Okay? Now in the units of 600 terahertz, which I'm going to use here, you don't have to if you don't want to. In each case, you'll be getting numbers that are twice as big if you use a unit of 300 terahertz. But with the units of 600 terahertz, what we've got here is half sum and half difference of the two pieces of the light. In other words, the factor 2 of blue shift minus the factor of 1/2 for the red shift. And then 2 plus 1/2. So the half difference and the half sum, that is what we use to designate the kappa, because there's a negative sign due to it's pointing this way right there. And then the frequencies, they're both positive. So you get a plus down here. So this thing here and this thing here, that's all multiplying Alice's frequency of 600 terahertz, indicating by a green new Alice, new sub Alice. Okay? So this is a vector that we're interested in. That's the phase vector. It's located here at 3/4 and 5/4, which we can read off from the graph. I'm using this right here as a unit, right here, the 600 terahertz, you see. So this one, a little bit bigger than 1, this is a little bit less than 1. Okay? Make sense? So there's your phase. There's your phase vector quantified. But not quite. I want a formula that will work for all rapidities. Okay? So we go back, the same picture, but let's put in what we really have here. We have e to the rho, positive rho, making 2. In this case, that's 1200 terahertz when multiplied by 600. So I'm going to take Alice's thing right here, and the phase, the kappa phase and the new phase are going to be here, e to the rho, e to the rho, and then they're going to be minus e to the minus rho and plus e to the minus rho. So what you're going to get here is a difference in a sum of the positive and negative exponentials, which is hyperbolic sine and hyperbolic cosine. And that's what we started with right here, is this trying to determine velocity of two different colored waves making a pattern. In this case, we're looking at the phase part, and that's the speed of that thing would be this over that. That would be 5/4 over 3/4. That would be 5/3. This divided by that frequency divided by kappa, that's the speed of anything, whether it's phase group or of your original waves that make the right and left laser beams. This is making sense. This is the heart of the whole thing that gets us out of the Galilean world. And we take Galileo along with us because the rows are making him very happy. And we get to see how waves work, how light waves work, the most important waves of all. Okay? And we can go ahead and do it with a group, too. The new grandstand as opposed to the new pitcher mound. We just figured out where the new pitcher mound is. Well, the new grandstand's down here. Now we're taking kappa prime of the group. That should obviously be the letter, that should be the word group. It's another copy and paste and not read. So that should be group there. And that's what we're looking at. We're looking at this vector right here, having a component of 5/4 on this side and 3/4 on this side, just the opposite of this one. So they're both symmetrically deployed around that main vector there. That right-handed vector. Okay? All right. Here's the formula. Just flip the sines and cosines and you've got the group vector. So one of them is going to be slower, the other is faster than light. Okay? All right. I'm going to bring this guy up to speed here. Do all this adding and subtracting, halving and summing over 2. And the deal is that when you get done with that, you make a wave that cuts that pattern. And that was why I gave you that homework problem, is to work out in space and time what you get from that arrangement. Right? That was the deal. Okay, so there it is, and we have to talk about that. That's really important, okay? As Bob is saying here, these space-time wave zeros replicate what goes on in per-space-time, except for the fact that the phase and the group switched again, just like they were before we started going anywhere with this. So what we need to do is measure these things in careful detail. That's the main purpose of the next part of this thing, is to look really carefully at all parameters that, come on, let's do some animation real quick before we do that, just so you can see this thing in motion again. We've already looked at it very briefly, but it wouldn't hurt to see it one more time. Question is whether I want to do it on this screen or on the other one. We want to do this one too. Maybe we can do both of them. Okay, then we'll get into the 16 parameters. So let me drop back here to here, or maybe go forward. Let's see if I'm right here. There we go. And see if I can get that thing up and running. Here it is, what it's going to look like, but we got to get it moving to really believe it. Okay. Now it's a little hard to see. This part's easy, that part's easy. Here come these two waves, and they're zeros, CW infrared, CW ultraviolet, making a pattern in the middle here. And the thing that you can pretty easily see is that the group wave is the one cutting this thing. So the group wave is the thing that's making the time for us. The phase part is cutting the zeros there. Now, the zero for the x axes. So let me go into controls here and pull up this scenario in a single panel way. And I've got to find it here. CW minus 1 and plus 4, that's what we've got. There we go. And then I'm going to go into controls here, and I'm going to set it so that it traces the phase zeros. Okay, and I might as well do the group zeros while I'm at it too. Okay, so let's accept t equals 0. See the arrows? They're the ones that are generating this. They used to go infinitely fast. Now it's just 5/3 the speed of light. Slowed down quite a bit. Meanwhile, the group, of course, has picked up to 3/5. You're getting an idea how waves make the world? That's what this is showing. And it's all we're all made out of these damn things. So we obey the laws that we're writing, starting to write now. Really, really a key idea that needs lots of look. Okay, so what I want to do is I want to fill this table like I'm going to ask you to do on your homework. I want to fill this table with all the quantities. Probably there's 16, but they're incredibly incestuous in the sense that all of them are really just other sides of this of one parameter, and that's the Evensen axiom, all colors go C. It's really quite beautiful. So what we're going to start with, we're going to start with the blue shifted guy. Okay? This thing right here, e to the rho, okay? Which is 2. Okay? E to the plus rho, which is 1 over the Doppler red. We'll get to him in a minute. He's on the other side. So this table is going to consist of numbers, each one on this side a reciprocal of the one on this side. Every number here, that's reciprocal. And number here, that's reciprocal. Number here, reciprocal to that. Okay? So I've got them all laid out so that they have an algebraic symmetry as well as a geometrical one. So there's the phase frequency right there. Okay? We've already got that. It's one of the components. This 5/4 here, 1.25. Okay? Phase frequency. What the heck does that mean in space and time? I can see what it is here, but what does it give over there? That was a homework problem that you've hopefully gotten most of the way through by now. Okay? Once you know this, then you should be able to know what's the distance between the crest lines measured along the time axis. Right? When do they cut the time axis? That is a period right there that we're after. Okay? The phase frequency, 5/4, flips to 4/5. That's 0.8. Okay? So, when we get that period right there, it goes right here. We'll jump ahead here. Okay? So it flips, and that's the number you get. These two are reciprocal of each other. They're very important. Pieces of relativity right there. One of them is the Lorentz-Fitzgerald contraction. Okay. Now, let's see what's next here. We're going to look at the kappa. Okay. The kappa is this component right here. So this is all to do with the phase vector. We'll worry about the group later on. But this is the two components of those, which we've already shown are sine and cosine, hyperbolic sine and hyperbolic cosine, 3/4 and 5/4 is the actual vector that represents the p vector. Okay? So this number here, the new prime phase, flips the 5/4 to 4/5, 0.8. That gives you this phase period. Right there, 0.8. Okay. And you start at the origin. If you happen to start at the origin, you just measure up here, 0.5, 0.6, 0.7, 0.8, right there. But it's going to be 0.8 everywhere. and up and down too, you see. So it's trying to tell you an answer, and it tells you an infinite number of times practically. Okay? The second one here, and I've got to get, try to keep this thing from misbehaving. There we go. Okay. So the phase wave number, phase wave length, are flips of each other. Okay, we're now talking about that right there. So I'm going to be seeing a 3/4 for the phase wave number. Okay, that's this right here, 0.5, 0.6, 0.75, right there, 3/4. Okay, and that's what's neat about this. If you pick Doppler shifts that are rational, all the other quantities come out to be rational as well. That is a very powerful piece of symmetry that we'll try to use a little bit later. So anyway, 3/4 becomes 4/3 for the wavelength. Now the wavelength is this. That's big. That's big. Big wavelength there. Okay. Now remember, we're talking about the wavelength between the two zeros. You go from here. Let's see if I got that right. The lambda phase. The phase that we're talking about is the thing that's going really fast. That's this one right here, you see, and it's the distance between two of those things. There's one of them, there's another one, and then there's another one right there. Just off, sort of off the edge there a little bit. Okay. It's not trivial to read these waves. You can get confused. And see sometimes why Newton just hated waves. He just did the craziest thing. They make you dizzy, and you shouldn't look at them. Anyway, this is important too, because the ratio of these is giving us that phase velocity. That 5/3, 1.67, is how fast this thing goes compared to the speed of light. And the point is, never goes less than the speed of light. Never reaches the speed of light. It comes down from the top, but it never makes it. Now, the next step is the group part, okay? Dopplerized group quantities. Here's the G right here, okay? We've got a frequency of the group, that's first thing off thing. That's going to flip to the period for the group, okay? And it's those numbers that are going to finish our table for us just about here. Okay? There's the group period right here. The flip of the group frequency, okay, 3/4 is a flip of 4/3, okay. And there is a little unfortunate thing here is that the group period comes very close to a number that's associated with the period of the phase. So you have to watch out for that. Those two numbers are fairly close, and it's really interesting to set the thing so they become equal. But anyway, this guy right here, 5/4, now we're talking about the group wave number, okay? Group wave number is a big 1 1/4, 5/4. It's going to flip to 4/5. That'll be our group wave length, okay? This is between those things, cutting the x-axis right there at 0.8. All right? Making sense? Okay? This slope, 4/5 over 4/3 is 3/5. We already knew that. That's the speed of Alice and Carla relative to Bob, or Bob relative to them with a minus sign. Okay, now here is the beginning of the physics. First of all, there are two things that everyone knows and knows relativity. First of all, if you're just a sophomore, you learn these two guys, two famous name coefficients. And if you're a little bit advanced, say junior or so, you might get the Lorentz transformation, okay? And here's the Lorentz transformation. It's nothing but a matrix with cosh, sin, sinh, cosh. No minus sign, or minus sign in both places. Very unlike a rotation in that sense. This is always symmetric. Rotation's always anti-symmetric. They're related, though, as it turns out. Now, this is the transformation of the original G and P to these new P and G. Okay? Old grandstand, old pitcher's mound, new pitcher's mound, new grandstand. Okay? That's the Lorentz transformation of the basis. Okay? So all the numbers are in place. It's all very good. But let's see the ones that you usually get taught first. And they're weird. They're totally weird. We're going to have to talk about them. Einstein time dilation, here by 25% dilated. Okay? We're talking about the new phase, the heartbeat. The heartbeat is looking slow. It used to be 1 in these units. Now it's 1.25. It takes 25% longer. You see, whereas before it went you see? So that's the time dilation, a slowing, you might say, of the heartbeat. And new phase is the heartbeat, so that's where it belongs. And then the Lorentz length contraction, you see, here contracted by 20% from 1 to 0.8. Okay? Now here's the old-fashioned notation. If you put the beta formula that we just derived in for these guys, you may have seen these formulas before. Okay? This is a horrible way to do algebra. This is single button push on a calculator. This is quite a few button pushes. Okay? But mostly it's the geometry we get from this. You see, that's really so cool. Alright? So that's the thing, and I guess with time not going slow, I don't want to rush this one, because this is where you find out that you could have taught this stuff to Thales in 600 BC. That's Thales' little circle that we showed on the phaser, right? This is what it looks like when you pull it out on the per-space-time diagram. But it's also in space and time, because what's the difference? We're not seeing much. Well, if you aren't spooked out yet, just wait.